Let's talk about Trisha Paytas and Ethan Klein. Hey everyone, welcome back to today's podcast. My name is Brittany Simon. If you're listening on Spotify, thank you very much. And if you're over on Patreon, double thank you very much. All right, to my left, I have not a tea, but an apple cider vinegar honey mixture. So I'm obsessed with apple cider vinegar. I think it's delicious. My nephew, who's about 3 right now, him and I, like, every time he drinks it, he goes, spicy. And it's because it has that vinegariness about it. I love it, even though it makes my nose, oh my gosh, have one of those moments. I actually do enjoy drinking it. So I do about this much apple cider vinegar and about this much water and then about a teaspoon or tablespoon of honey, depending on my mood. I do like it sweeter rather than more vinegary. So that is my suggestion for today. Instead of a tea, I decided to share this drink because that's just what I'm drinking right now. All right. I'm going to be honest. I feel like I'm already out of breath and we haven't even started the podcast. You know, this is my job, right? This is my job. But at the same time, I feel so burdened, I think, by the reality that I'm talking about real people. I think as I've gotten older and I've been engrossed in YouTube controversy, even the small amount I felt so heavy that I can only assume Ethan and Trisha both feel the heaviness of everyone talking about their lives. And even though they're celebrities and they've consented by being public figures, as a YouTuber, I can't help but feel a great amount of empathy for them because at the same time, even though Trisha has used all of her controversies to be famous, I actually think it's an underlining issue correlated with her mental illness and her association with abandonment more than her just being a scoundrel on the internet. And on the same front, I think that Ethan is a person who's so genuine that he forgets that YouTube is a cesspool of awful people. And so because of that, just like keep in mind as we're talking about real people. So I watched the apology videos they made and you guys really wanted to know my opinion. And I know a lot of you are new to my channel and you might not know my work, but my work has been different over the years. You know, I started off as a very different person than I am today. But the thing that I want to make just so certain that my content stays, I just want to make sure my content stays true to my value system. And so when we review the apologies, which we're about to do, or at least hear my thoughts on it, just remember, right, that I'm only judging them in a very gay way. Like, I'm sassy judging them, but I'm not really judging them. I don't think Ethan and Trisha are evil people. And because they're not evil, I think they're human. And even though humans can be evil, in this situation, they're just being pretty predictable. Humans are going to human is a little slogan here on this channel. And so when we observe them, just try to observe them with a great deal of compassion, meaning to suffer with. And maybe you can't. Maybe because you're not a YouTuber, you maybe don't know, or maybe because you're not a public figure, or maybe you've never had your family drama on the internet, or maybe you've never had someone tell false stories about you, but it is crushing and demoralizing. And so just have a little bit of compassion. So we're going to try to observe them both through the levels, right? My level system is an observational philosophy I created with a co-author who would like to remain anonymous. So if you guys are new to my channel, check out the links in the description for the shorthand version and the longhand version. Watch both before you ask any questions, because I think both give, in conjunction with each other, just give a really good idea of what the levels are and then answers a lot of your questions. Now, Trisha and Ethan are currently, in my view, twos. Twos are, they make up most of the world's population, people who exist within bubbles and operate within bubbles. You obviously, if you've been following Trisha as long as I have, which is too long, and I don't watch every single thing Trisha does. I really don't. I don't need to. I just check in once in a while to see how she's doing. But I know overall that her journey has only thrived in a specific bubble. So if you look at Trisha with compassion and you recognize she's a two stuck in the world of the twos, meaning stuck in her specific bubble, and she's really never left her bubbles, to be honest. She's always thrived within that toxic celebrity YouTube culture. She's thrived off drama and her mental illnesses. She's thrived off people hating her and her, in my opinion, doubling down on her own feelings. I actually think she pushes down her own feelings in order to continue making content. Because if I'm going to be completely honest, a normal, healthy person could not handle the amount of shit Trisha's had thrown at her. Because regardless of if she brought it on herself, the backlash should impact a normally healthy-ish person. They don't have to be completely healthy, but enough to know that maybe I'm doing something wrong, which is why I think a lot of people, because she's scored so high on the narcissism scale, think she's a narcissist. I'm not a therapist. I'm not any of those things. I'm a professional conversationalist. I'm a human being. I'm speaking from experience and I'm speaking, you know, with the knowledge I have from what I've read and studied. But in general, right, like, I'm not a therapist. I have no idea if Trisha's a narc. But what I do know she is a person who is suffering in a way that is not even comprehensible to myself. I can't even comprehend Trisha's suffering, because the little bit of relatable backlash I have received in my life, very short-lived, created by a stalker, I totally got through it. It almost killed me. I thought I was going to kill myself. Like, I literally went home to my parents and cried on their floor and was like, I'm going to do it. I'm finally going to do it. Like, it's too much. You know what I mean? And that's a fraction. I mean, a literal, like, speck in the universe compared to the amount of backlash Trisha's had to face. I couldn't imagine myself doing it again, which begs the question, YouTuber to YouTuber, as I look at Trisha, why do you keep doing this to yourself? But Trisha could say the same thing to me. Well, why'd you stay on YouTube? You left. You could have left permanently. And it's because I love the work. I love this. And if you view Trisha, and especially through the lens of a creator, I understand her. Trisha's musical videos, like the music videos she puts out, are so good. Like, just, you know, as somebody who herself relates a lot to a version of Trisha, like the Hollywood, Broadway, singing, performing person. Because when I was little, it was really common to have performance dreams. Oh, I'm going to be the next Destiny's Child. I'm going to be the next TLC. I'm going to be the next, you know, Britney Spears. I'm going to be the lead singer of a Christian band. Yeah, I tried that one time with my girlfriends in middle school. Of course, I never went anywhere. I was never going to be good enough to do that. I was never going to dedicate enough of my time to be good enough to do that. Trisha puts so much of her own money into her videos just to create them, when we know her views have been short. She's not getting the same ad revenue from YouTube. And yes, she has tons of money from OF. And that's not, again, this isn't even about money. It's the mental torture she's putting herself through to be able to perform. That, as a content creator, I completely understand. Like, I can't even explain it to you. But those of you who are content creators, you know there's a reason you keep coming back. And it's not about the money. It's really not. Like, when Trisha makes her music videos, it's not about the money. When she's doing everything else, yeah, I think the fear of not having money plagues Trisha. She's always worried she's in debt. She's always saying she doesn't have money. And that usually stems from someone who also doesn't know how to keep money. Because I make far less than Trisha, right? I'll never make as much as Trisha, but I'm not struggling with money. You know what I'm saying? I think that's most of America. You know, even if we're living paycheck to paycheck, we're not like millions of dollars in debt. You know what I'm saying? And I'm not saying Trisha is either, but sometimes in her videos, she makes it sound like she is. And it's almost confusing to the rest of us, but that's because we don't know exactly how much she makes. All of those things don't matter. The whole point is that, remember, when you're viewing Trisha, you really don't know her. You only know parts of her. I am so honored that my last video on Trisha Paytas, you guys felt like I really nailed it. But remember, I'm just a person observing human beings, and I am still not the predictor of all things. I am not perfect. So I could get things so wrong about Trisha. Now, the only reason I feel very confident about my assessments is because I'm okay being wrong. And also, I feel like I've made one of the best cases for Trisha. A woman who's come from a broken home, struggling with a mental illness, smart enough to capitalize on that mental illness, but not smart enough to fix her mental illness enough to actually form what she really wants, which is a loving, insecure home with a consistent group of people. Ironically enough, one of the main symptoms of borderline personality disorder is that we push away people instead of bonding, because the vulnerability makes us scared we're going to get abandoned after we've opened up. I myself am a professional runner awayer. One of the things that I have been battling throughout my life, which I'll probably still always battle, not necessarily with my inner circle, because I told you, once you're inner circle, I'm good. I'm set. My brain has already accepted you as guild. Like, you are, I'm Natsu and you are my guild and I will never let you go. But that's why I am so strict about who gets into inner circle, because I know I could end up giving up my life for those people. We would all do that for each other. And that, I think, is what ultimately people want, to love and be loved. And to say that Trisha as a human doesn't want this, I think neglects the people in our society who are honestly struggling in a way that I will never understand. I will never understand what it is like to be Trisha Paytas, to have a brain that self-sabotages to the extent hers does. Because mine does not do that. There are parts of me, yes, there are parts of you we all see in Trisha. But Trisha, Habibi, makes this 49-minute apology video, which I sat all the way through. And in the whole video, not only is her body, her physical behavior a manic, not only is her voice fluctuating, not only is she looking anxious and also confused, almost like she's speaking, like almost like she is hearing the voices in her head, which we know she has schizophrenia. We know she was hearing voices. She says they're gone now. But to be completely honest, the issue with mentally ill people is not the people who are higher functioning and can eventually get over it. And I know a lot of people didn't like the higher functioning, low functioning thing. I don't know what to tell you. I don't know how you're ever going to get better if you don't admit where you are in the spectrum. And for me, knowing where I was allowed me to know how to move forward. And I still needed a lot of self-care. But to say that Trisha and I, as an example, both who have borderline, are the same people is so fucked up. Not only because of all the work I've done, and not only because of where she is in the privilege scale of money, but it just shows you that obviously it's not just about having money and support, because Trisha has those things. It's about her ability to actually do those things. Now, is she not getting better because her mental illness and she's lower functioning? Maybe. Or is she choosing to continue being this person? I don't know. I don't know. In about four months, I'm going to give her 6 months from the time the fight first started. I'm going to come back and make one more video about Trisha. Against my philosophy system on whether or not she's a one or a two, I still think she's currently a two. I think she struggles. I think her mental illness is stopping her. But if that's the only thing that's stopping Trisha, then with the right and proper means, she can get better. But it's not money, and it's not just a support system. And I think that's the problem. I think it's coming from within herself. I think she's lacking any sort of identity within herself that she can cling to without the validation of another person. Moses has obviously, her fiance, has obviously become her favorite person. In the apology video, she made it very clear throughout the apology video that she was so glad she had Moses, that she can't believe no matter what she does, he's there.
Trying to think if there's any other apologies. I'm really sorry. I really am. It's the stages of a Trish freak out, and I feel good. I feel strong. I feel like, you know, loved and cared for over here. With all this now put out there, I feel like I can fully move on. So maybe this was a selfish apology, but I hope it can give some peace to Ethan, the crew, and Hila that I'm sorry. And I hope in time that we will be able to talk again. Like, I know once trust is broken, like, it's nearly impossible to gain back, but I'm willing to put in effort and, you know, at the end of the day, you are my fiance's family, and I respect that so much, probably more than anyone would know, but I respect that so much. And ultimately, Ethan and Hila are the reason me and Moses are together and happy. I found someone who really does love me unconditionally, and I ultimately apologize to Moses. He always tells me, stop, you don't need to apologize. Like, I'm always like, I ruined your life. I did all this, you know, I ruined our life. We ruined a good thing. You know, we saw your family more, and like, stop it. He's someone who's just always so supportive, but I do have to start thinking about, you know, there's Moses. I'm not trying to embarrass him with all this. You know, all of our past traumas get brought up, past conflicts, past hurdles got dragged up again, and it's not easy. It's, you know, you read that stuff and you're like, you know, I start thinking like, you shouldn't be with me, you shouldn't do that, you know, I shouldn't be with you, like, you know, this isn't gonna work, this is how we're going into our marriage. And he's like, but it's not, you know, we healed it, we resolved it. And that's again just differentiating the internet versus reality. The irony of that, that was Ethan's first video about me.
There has been a lot of sympathy for Moses. There have been a lot of people who, you know, what about Moses, Brittany? What about Moses? Aren't we worried about Moses? No, I'm not worried about Moses. Like, not really. For two reasons. Okay, so how do I say this? Trisha, because of who she is, needs two kinds of men. Either the man who's Moses and supports her and is a yes man and is team Trisha all the way. Or, and she ultimately is in charge. Or she needs a man who's more dominant than she is, but also is team Trisha and loves her and wants to get her better, but has a little bit more of aggressive, like if I dated Trisha versus like Moses dating Trisha, right? I would have a very different set of requirements for Trisha dating me than Moses would, right? We're two different personalities. I'm more dominant. Moses is more passive. And this is why I always say like disagreeable women and agreeable women, right? With men, it's a little different and I'm not a man, so I don't know how to like really understand that part of their brain. But if I'm understanding women correctly, which I am, Trisha is an agreeable woman. And I know that sounds really strange because she's so fucking just cuntiful sometimes. Like she's just so annoying and she screams so she appears dominant. But screaming is actually not a sign of dominance to me. A need to be too loud just says to me like, hey, you know, the louder you get, the weaker you look. So, and as a person who's very loud, but when I am serious, my tone doesn't go louder. That means I've lost control. My tone goes quieter usually, or very specific, like, okay, stop. We don't have time for this. We need to get serious now and we need to move forward. It's like I move my voice deeper, but when I'm like happy, I'm like, oh my, stop. You stop, right? I'm when I look at Trisha or Moses, I'm not thinking, oh, I'm going to make this all about me. And that's why I'm using examples of myself. I'm saying these are real humans who have real feelings. And I'm a human and I have feelings. You should be doing this too. Think about the ways that other people's lives are really just a window into our own. Even if they're not exactly like ours, we are relatable to one another. This division, this separation, this idea that we're all not the same is so silly, right? It comes from the world of the twos. Again, because we all come from bubbles, we all grew up thinking our bubble's the correct bubble. And maybe it is, who knows? But I most certainly have lived a life that has allowed me an opportunity to travel within all these bubbles, these lifestyles, these cultures. And it means that I've had insight into how people act, and we're really not all that different anywhere. Humans want to love and be loved. Kids feel like they don't have the coolest shoes. They're lame. Men feel like the need to show dominance. Women feel a need to show, you know, they have a place and they're needed. Like we all have these desires as a human species. We are not so unique that our past ancestors cannot help us understand each other. We must stand on the shoulders of giants. And at the same time, we are so unique and important and valid. Trisha is not just somebody who should be thrown away, but Trisha has the right to throw away her own life. Moses has the right to throw away his life. And I think that's the controversy we're all facing within ourselves, is how many times in our life are we given opportunities and we still throw our lives away? And at what point are you a number two who's just bad at it? And at what point are you a one, a useless human who, no matter your resources, no matter who's laid down their life for you, just never steps up to the plate? Trisha has about 4 months before I deem her like a number one. Useless. Because she has every single reason to succeed at this point in her life. And she's choosing not to. And that is the saddest thing to see. And if you feel vindicated, if you feel happy that Trisha is failing, I'm sorry for you as well. Because this is so sad to watch. A person who has come such a long way. If you watch this apology video of Trisha and then watch her apology videos of her past controversies and you think this is the same person, you are not paying attention. One of the things that I see as a pattern is that Trisha will go from friend group to friend group, and she has some sense of values. Like she does have some things that she thinks is wrong, but I don't know which ones they are yet. I don't actually know if she holds any real moral belief. It's funny, somebody came onto my channel and told me, you have no strong sense of morals, which is such an interesting thing because some people think I'm so black and white in my thinking that I have a very strict sense of morals. But if you look at my value system, especially in relation to the value, to the level system, the philosophy system, there is a clear idea that people, when exhibiting free will, can be judged in a way that is honest, but not damning. And I think the issue with the concept of morals is that people want you to damn them. People want to be damned. Like when Trisha and Ethan went after David Dobrik's group, ignoring the fact that Trisha crashed a car into Jason's house, or that Trisha caused a lot of controversy, or that Trisha was willing to do more than enough to get famous or to have famous friends, the fact that she still kind of yearns for Shane Dawson, or the fact that she hung out with Jeffrey. Like, I know you all loved when, and I know the vindictiveness of the T channels, and which is why I don't want my channel to become this, but I understand that you want blood. I see you. I read your comments. I see you. You want people to be destroyed. And that is so number two of you, to think that your bubble is the most vindicated one. It was the issue with Ethan going after David Dobrik, to think that him and Trisha have the right to throw stones given who they are is just so interesting to me. And the only reason it's forgivable in the slightest is because Ethan is so fucking genuine. The only reason it is tolerable that Ethan goes after anyone is because he is so genuine. He thinks he's doing the good, like the Lord's work. And he thinks he has the right to, which is so interesting. Trisha, on the other hand, you saw the way people embraced Trisha when Ethan approved of her. You see how Trisha became this wonderful pick-me girl that finally found her white knight who supported her, and, you know, just went after all these YouTubers for her, allowed her to talk shit on so many people. He just, like, boosted her and boosted her and boosted her. And Ethan, being the white knight he is, felt vindicated because, oh my gosh, Trisha finally needs me. A woman needs me. It definitely isn't my wife, even though his wife needs him, but not in the way that he necessarily can provide at all points. But, man, what does a white knight need who's a man who's not a real, like, soldier for his queen, but, like, a literal white knight, like a simp, is a Trisha. Who all he has to do, the most work he has to do is say she's amazing, she looks skinny today, and she's great. But when you have like an Ela, when you have an Ela who's like a warrior queen, who's like a Joan of Arc, who's like a CEO and like a dominant person, but a shy person, you don't need necessarily a cheerleader because you're doing it already. What you need is someone you can rely on to do the right thing for business and family and your life. So again, this isn't just a criticism of Trisha or Ethan or Ela or any of these people. What it is just an observation that we're all tropes. We fall into anime characters or book characters or whatever you want to say. And at the end of the day, there's no way for Trisha to be the Ela. No way for Ela to be the Ethan. No way for Ethan to be the Trisha. They are all their own tropes. And they all fall into categories that many of us can relate to. What I noticed in relation to this was how many YouTubers accepted Trisha because Ethan said, nah, give her a chance, guys, give her a chance. But the moment Trisha fucked up, all of them jumped on this bandwagon of fuck Trisha, never trusted her, Ethan was an idiot, shouldn't have done this. Even Philip DeVranco was getting some sweet, sadistic satisfaction over Trisha's failure, which I think is just a bummer. Like, I know I've been watching Phil's career too since day one, and him and I have definitely had interactions in the past, and I have no ill will towards Phil whatsoever. But there's a reason I stopped watching his show, because and I know he knows he's biased, but he's so in a bubble. It is just so hard. His joy over going after David Dobrik, his joy over going after, you know, Trisha, it just, I don't think this is what leads people to joy. I think the negative feelings we have around each other, the feeling of like, yeah, she got hers. I think sometimes if you're a direct victim, it can be healthy. But I think overall, holding on to these grudges is unhealthy. And at the same time, how does Ethan defend himself? He does what he's doing now, which is to acknowledge that she made an apology, but to make it clear that by accepting her apology, whether he does or not, it doesn't change what she's done. He feels in the moment that she genuinely came after him, and he feels unsafe with her now.
And, you know, if this is an apology to me, right? It says apology to Ethan. This is my apology. Oh, I watched the whole 40-minute video, and I watched all 10 mid-rolls. It's like, do I have to watch 10 mid-rolls to get my apology? Why do I have to watch 10 mid-rolls to get my apology? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 mid-rolls. If this is an apology to me, why do I have to watch it on her YouTube channel with 10 mid-rolls? She has my number. She knows that I'm open to talk anytime. She missed, you know what I mean? And she apologized to the crew. She said previously she doesn't have any of the crew's contact information. I'm sorry, but that's not true. We're all in a group chat on WhatsApp. She has everybody's phone number. She could have called them to apologize. They don't need to watch 11 mid-rolls to get their apology either. So do I appreciate her apology? Yes, it is nice and helpful just to clear the air. But is it the most personal and meaningful apology that I have to watch it on her YouTube channel with 11 mid-rolls? No. I don't know. It's like, you know, and she says stuff like, you know, I'm over wanting an apology. I have to move on. I honestly don't know. This is someone who I've tried my best in every conceivable way to be loving and supportive and gracious. And then like the minute things went wrong this third time, I really feel like she tried to ruin my life. And the good thing for me is because, you know, another thing she says is, well, why did you post that final episode if it made me look so bad? First of all, you guys got to understand, Trisha put out her video before the final episode was even posted publicly. And, you know, she's the one who told me to post it. We were talking about it privately, and she was so convinced she was right. She's like, put it up unedited, and let's see who's right. And I was like, okay, maybe you're right. Maybe I'm the asshole. And so she told me to put it up. The only thing that saved me from Trisha trying to do everything to ruin my life is the fact that all of our fights and confrontation were put up unedited on Frenemies. Because if I was like, you know what, I'm going to not air this to protect Trisha, unfortunately, that gives Trisha all the space she needs to say, well, this is what happened. This is whatever happened, happened. And then it's my word against her. I don't know. I just think, like, it scares me. It scares me because this is someone who I confide in, who I consider friend and family, and someone who was, you know, willing at the time of crisis to go out publicly and say anything about me. And I frankly can't risk, as much as I love and respect Trisha and she's so talented, entertaining, and all the great things about her, I can't risk having someone close to me in my life who was willing to just step out into the public eye and say anything about me when things go a little south. That's just not something that I can accept, frankly.
This is the hardest part of caring for somebody who's mentally ill or just somebody who's hard to deal with, is that the person, especially, let's say, with borderline, since some of the worst cases of borderline can really aggressively and violently push people away from them, even though ultimately they want to be loved, the thing they forget is, regardless of your mental illness, you have real life consequences for what you're doing. And that's why I think if your mental illness is served by how you feel, which I think has been the narrative that's been pushed the last 5 years, which I think is really bad, or 10 years, instead of actually thinking how you are impacting others, I think you can manifest your mental illness, like you can grow your mental illness into a worse state than it is. I think Trisha does this thing where she, because she has a mental illness and she shows off her DBT cards and she pretends like she knows what she's doing. By the way, did you notice when she showed off her DBT cards online, she specifically showed off the ones about self-love? It is so easy to say self-love. It is so easy to say I'm the victim. It is so easy to say I'm at fault without ever taking responsibility for it. You're still at fault if you're the victim, especially if the victim is because of your mental illness. You can say you're a victim because you were born with a mental illness or because you had one as a child, but there's another side of victimhood that I think is self-inflicted. And I think that's when you have the money and the resources to get better and you don't. At that point, you're just indulging yourself in something that you know you'll miss when it's gone. And I think sick people do this. We lash out and we hurt the people around us when we don't even mean to, but it's how we genuinely feel. And that's why I have an issue with the idea that feelings are valid, because even saying that, people like Trisha, their brain stops there. So you can say your feelings are valid, that but doesn't mean your actions are, but they don't never hear that second part, which is why I always say maybe your feelings aren't always valid. Because at first I did used to say, oh, your feelings are valid, but your actions are not. And it never sank through to mentally ill people around me or myself. And then I realized, you know what? Maybe my feelings aren't valid either. Maybe I'm not even supposed to be feeling this way. Maybe if I was healthy, I wouldn't even feel this way. And if that's the case, then my feelings can't be valid just because they're happening. Right? Isn't that like saying the aggression in a drunk who beats up his wife is valid because he feels it? Well, that doesn't make sense. And I know what you're saying. You're imagining a meek, small victim, like victim-y person who's crying in a corner who can't fight back. And I'm imagining a Trisha, a person who does fight back, a person who tells secrets on the internet or makes Ethan feel unsafe. I'm talking about a grown woman with the resources to ruin someone's life, if people take her seriously. Which brings us to the idea of, when do people need to be taken seriously? You know, when I was growing up, crazy people were just crazy people. You ignored them. you know? You let them be crazy, and then you just kind of went, oop, crazy person. But now, crazy people have platforms, voices. They get to take us to court. They get to pretend that their narrative is true. They get to tell complete lies, and I can't even battle them in a duel. I just have to let it happen, right? We all have to just let it happen. Ethan and Trisha put their whole family on blast on the internet without ever considering how this is going to impact everyone around them. And this tells me in some ways that this apology meant everything because we needed to see it as an audience and nothing to the family of the Kleins or the Trishas, the Kleins and the Paytases. Because the reality is that if they were truly family, if they were truly guild, if they were truly inner circle, this would never have been on the internet. They would take it down right now. You know, I went home 2 weeks ago to see my folks. It was so nice. Oh my gosh. So good. One of you recently said in my comment section for the live show I think we did on Friday, somebody said, I love how supportive your parents are. They sound awesome. And I was laughing. And some people who've been following me were laughing because I was like, oh, my bros, if you only knew how much of a battle it was for my family and I to like become good. Because guilds aren't born overnight, right? Like they happen over years through intimacy, through going through hell and getting out together. When shit hits the fan, I pay attention to who has my back. I pay attention. Your inner circle, you know, through trials and tribulations, you don't just become inner circle because we're dating. You don't just become, like, obviously the person I marry has to be inner circle. But if we're just dating, you're being tested, my friend. When I went through like some of the hardest times in my life, I went home to my inner circle. I went home to my guild and they held me and they were like, who do I need to beat up? And they told me that like I was valid and wonderful and that they would help me get better and hold myself accountable. And during my like darkest time, I had my inner circle. I don't know that Trisha ever has that. I don't think she has it with her sister or even her mother. Trisha's talked about how hard their life has been. Ethan, regardless of how much he in the past talked about his parents. Did you guys see the new Families podcast? His mom and dad show up. They're there for him. And you notice how much calmer Ethan is? Have you noticed how much happier he looks? People forget, if you're a mentally ill person who explodes constantly, then the people around you can be on edge around you, never knowing if this is going to make you switch or this is going to make you switch or this is going to make you switch. And especially if they're not aggressive like somebody like me, they might feel a need to just let you be crazy versus like, I don't tolerate it anymore because it makes me crazy. I'm like, no, serious Brittany voice, no. Sometimes I even BDSM safe word on people, red, not happening, stop. Stop the talk, stop the scene, stop whatever's happening right now, not interested. And most people don't have that language or even have the safety of that language. My inner circle, if we're on each other's toes, if we're getting in each other's business, we usually can just say something, even if it turns into a fight or even if we're yelling. The next day, we make amends or I'll send a text or I'll remind people like, hey, I know we fought, but we're inner circle. We never doubt that the people will be in our lives. It just matters. It just depends on what capacity they are. But I know when shit hits the fan, I have those people. And I know that ultimately that's what Trisha wants. Ultimately, that's what Ethan thought he was for Trisha. But for Trisha to share their text messages, and you can tell Trisha's insane because Habibi put a text message of her saying Jewy in public, which you know pisses off Twitter, which for me does not piss me off. So here's the thing. Hear me when I say this. If you're in my inner circle and you do not make a terrorist joke to my face, you cannot be trusted. Inner circle means you can make any joke, be any person, say basically anything as long as it's coming from a non-malicious place and I will not fight you. I will find the humor and I will know that you are a good person and this is a funny thing for you. If I couldn't even imagine, like my bestie of 20 years, you guys saw her and I do a video together. She's white. And I just couldn't imagine a scenario in which we were best friends and we knew everything about each other and she couldn't make a joke at me. Like, I just couldn't even imagine that reality. Like, I would feel so unseen. Because let me tell you this. I got this in Seattle a lot, where people, because they didn't, I feel like if you don't acknowledge the stereotypes of my people, then you're not really seeing me, and you're seeing me as a version of me that doesn't exist. If you don't see my gayness, if you don't see my queerness, if you don't see all the things that make me who I am, then, like, what do you see? My parents might disagree with queer relationships, but they see my gayness. You know how I know that? Because my mom is sus anytime I'm around a girl. You know what I'm saying? If she wasn't sus and didn't think I was into every girl that I was looking at, then she wouldn't, you know, if she thought I was really straight, she wouldn't be weird around, you know, me being around girls. But she knows I'm not straight, which is why she doesn't like me around other girls. Because I'm going to bring home a wife one day. Wife one day. Probably not. I'm probably going to bring home a man. Anyways, Ethan thought genuinely that he was really helping Trisha. And this is what I tell men. Stop assuming you can save every fucked up woman out there. And women, stop thinking you're going to save every fucked up guy out there. Save the people you genuinely love that are genuinely working on it and that are genuinely trying to be better. People have a core self. They really do. Even when they're being a complete piece of shit, they have a core self. And I do believe that core self is either good or bad. But to say that Trisha is just bad, I don't know. I don't believe it yet. To say that Ethan is bad, I do not believe it. To say that they are ignorant, naive, stereotypical, to say that they are beyond our help, maybe. But they're not living in our bubble. I don't live in the bubble of Ethan and Trisha. I have no idea what their life is like. I don't live there. I live in the middle of nowhere watching anime and trying to keep plants alive and, you know, minding my own business with my inner circle. I'm not in their life. You're not in their life. But if we're going to make a comment about a real person's existence, then we must acknowledge how hard it is to be human and how simple our desire is as a species to love and be loved, to have the functionality of our biology and our evolution, to move forward, to want greater things, to be better things. Trisha is a different person than she was 5 years ago. She's a slow to learn human. And I do not have the patience, but she's also not my inner circle, so I don't have to have the patience with her. Ethan can make a decision based off of what's best for his family in regards to Trisha, but whatever decision Ethan makes is going to be the right decision for Ethan, even if it's another lesson that needs to be learned in relation to Trisha. Because I've taken people back a few times, and I didn't learn until the third time, and trust me, I learned enough that I got permanent scars, and I got it. Okay, I learned it. Thank you, Jesus. I learned my lesson. But maybe Ethan hasn't. But the lesson that Ethan has to learn isn't one you or I can teach him. Truth must be discovered. And the philosophy system I created in the levels, a lot of people are like, Brittany, how do I find this peace about the earth? And how do I accept that the earth is exactly how it should be and people are doing exactly what they should be doing? If I could tell you, I just make a video. I'm trying my best to tell you, but I cannot explain to you that it was a lived experience. I lived a very difficult yet easy-ish life, because in comparison, my life has been easy. Like, I compare myself to my ancestors, and of course I have an easier life. Just like my family alone, my parents had a harder life than I did. And it's so easy to make fun of boomers and immigrants. It's so easy to stereotype people, whether they're white or people of color. It's so easy to feel so on a high horse about making fun of people. But I'm watching you, and I'm paying attention. There's definitely a time to make fun of people. 1,000,000,000,000%. And then there are times in which you have to remember the power you have in your life. No matter what side of the coin you're on, you have a power of how you want to be you in life. You have it. If you think you're smarter than Trisha, if you think you're smarter than Ethan, if you think you're smarter than me, then it better show in your life. Words are shit. Actions are everything. And I'm not going to believe you when you say Trisha's a worse person than you are if you do the same thing Trisha does, but on the other side. Because if you attack Trisha as a literal human, why? What has Trisha ever done to you personally? Not your communities, not people who look like you, not anything else. What has she done to you personal? Because I'm going to be honest with you. I do not have the ickiness inside me. I do not have like a dark cloud inside me enough to keep a grudge this long. I don't care who attacked my ancestors. I don't care what happened 100 years ago. I don't care about a lot of things. I care about what we're doing today. If you start becoming a better person today, I don't care what you did 24 hours ago. You might still need to be held accountable for it, but I'm not going to do it out of maliciousness or revenge. And that's the key. I want a King Solomon in this. I want to really consider that when we expect people to be better, we are too better. Or at least ruling with some sort of humanity within us. The justice system is not justice. Our humanity lies in how we treat other people and especially ourselves. Would I want to deal with Trisha? No. Would I want to deal with Ethan? No. But that's why they're not in my inner circle. Do you understand? Stop choosing people and then wondering why your life is chaotic. I have chosen people in the past that I swore would be in my inner circle one day, and I was gravely mistaken. The universe blessed me with a very hard life lesson, and I have learned from it. Thank you, universe. But I don't want to learn that lesson again. And so you must learn from your mistakes. Why do I have so much sympathy and compassion for Ethan and Trisha? Because they're people, and I don't think they're evil. And because of that, I hope they are better. And I wish them a great amount of luck, patience, and for God's sake, some real goddamn therapy. Not this fake validate therapy. My therapist was a complete BA. She literally was like, whoo-choo! She really made me think. And she never told me what to do. But she challenged me. And she, remember, she said, seek out your joy. And that's what I'm demanding you do today. Seek out your joy, not your just happiness, not a temporary emotion, your joy. If you want a family, start acting like it. If you want to love, be loving. If you want to show compassion, be compassionate. You can do whatever you want. You have the free will, and I know you're goddamn smart. So make a better decision starting right now. All right, that's it. That's all I want to say. I think that's all we need to say. And that's all I'm going to talk about Trisha Paytas for at least another 4 months. Sorry, guys. Take your time to think about these things. I know every YouTuber jumps on it. Every YouTuber wants that ad revenue. That has never been my style. I'm not going to be that kind of content creator. This is not a tea channel. This is a channel to help us be better, which means to observe and hold each other accountable according to our inner circle's values. Not my circle, not your circle. I don't expect you to hold me accountable. You're not my mother. I'm not going to hold you accountable. I'm not your mother. But your inner circle, you need to have people around you that truly know you so they can hold you accountable. I don't think communities can do that. I don't think strangers can hold other strangers accountable if they're really not looking at you with humanity. If you're just a number to someone, if you're just another asshole, then you're never going to get the justice you deserve. You're always going to get punishment and maliciousness towards you. And I don't want to be that person. I don't want that on my soul. I don't want to die and go to whatever universal heaven there might be and have someone say, you threw the stone when you lived in a glass house. Do you get what I'm saying? That is not to say you need to put up with bullshit. You can be strong while being compassionate. You can say, I love you, but I still have boundaries. I'm open, but I have boundaries. Ethan and Trisha are people. They do not impact us. We are not them. They are not related to us. We are not in their inner circle. Okay, talk to you guys soon. Have a great day. And yeah, okay, bye. In my head, in real life, I'm in bed. My belly's being fed, and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine. Not to you in my mind, cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed. So why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking. Yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth. And living life is a fool.